हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू माय ऑडियो ट्यूटोरियल। माय नेम इज़ हर्षित द्विवेदी। बिफोर दिस आई हैव अपलोडेड अराउंड 8 to 9 ऑडियो ट्यूटोरियल्स फॉर यू रिलेटिंग टू इंडियन पॉलिटी एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, एंड देर वुड बी 100, 200 और मे बी 500 or 600 ऑडियो ट्यूटोरियल्स आफ्टर दिस वन, इन विच आई विल टेल यू टोटली अबाउट इंडियन पॉलिटी एंड कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, the history of India, ancient history, medieval history, modern history, world history, geography of India, science and technology. At this point of time, I will not upload the current affairs section because obviously the current affairs section is very wide and it is changing day by day. So through my audio tutorials, I will cover the general studies syllabus of almost all competitive examinations which are of lower level than IAS and PCS examination. That is, the material of general studies that I will upload will help you in all objective examinations except the PCS and IAS mains examination. Even by reading this material or by consulting this material, you can get yourself prepared for IAS pre-examination. In fact, by reading this material only, I have cleared the IAS pre-examination myself. Obviously, I was not able to clear the IAS mains examination. Maybe in future, in my future attempts, I would be able to clear the IAS mains examination. So, this material is will be totally helpful to you from the perspective of IAS pre-examination, PCS pre-examinations, and all other objective type examinations like SBI PO, RBI, Grade B, and IBPS PO examinations, management training examinations, and also Staff Selection Commission combined graduate level examinations. Also, by hearing to these audio lectures, you will get yourself prepared for interviews, because nowadays it has become a common fashion and trend that in the interviews also questions related to our polity and history and general studies are asked. So it is very much required from our perspective and from the point of view of our preparation that we get ourselves acclaimed and accustomed to some basic sort of general studies. So here I am uploading the contents in detail. If you want, you can read whatever you can hear whatever you like. My uploaded tutorials are very much divided according to topics. They are not combined. All the audio tutorials are of average duration of 10 minutes or 13 minutes, and it is also not very boring for you. Hearing to these audio tutorials will not make you bored. And you can hear them at your perusal. That means you can hear them through your laptop also. You can hear them through your smartphone also if you have a normal 2G or 3G connection. The website from where you can view this or hear these audio tutorials, the name of the website is www.articlemaniac.org. I repeat, I will spell it www.articlemaniac.org. Articlemaniac.org. So when you will visit this website, articlemaniac.org, in the top bar you will see an option, General Studies. As soon as you will click on that option, General Studies, a page will open where all the topics will be listed. And at the right side of this topic, a play button will be displayed. As soon as you will push that button, the audio tutorial will start to play. So it's a very easy thing. You have to just log on to the website and hear those. And these audio tutorials are totally free, and you don't have to pay anything for them. It's just a gesture that I just want to help people, so I am providing these materials to you. But one important thing is there, that you cannot download these audio tutorials. If you have to listen to them, you have to come to the website. There is no other way of hearing these audio tutorials, and I will not allow the download of these audio tutorials, because after downloading they can be used for other purposes also. So if you want to hear these audio tutorials, you can go to the website and hear them totally free of cost. So now I will continue with the topic of my today's lecture. Today I will discuss about, today's lecture of mine or tutorial of mine is about the Government of India Act of 1935. Now, this Government of India Act of 1935 was one of the most significant acts of the administrative and political history of India. You can say that nowadays in our constitution, a whole lot of objectives and a whole lot of principle and a whole lot of ways and methods and ideologies are in continuance of the provisions that were made through the Government of India Act of 1935. So, we know that the different provisions of our Indian constitution are borrowed from the different constitutions of the world, and many provisions of our constitution are also borrowed from the Government of India Act of 1935. So, now I will point wise tell you about various features and important characteristics of the Government of India Act of 1935. Now, the very first characteristic, I will speak a bit slowly so that you can be able to catch up. So, in the previous audio tutorial, I told you that in the Government of India Act of 1919, a dual scheme of governance was formed that was known as dyarchy, DYARCHY. So, in the Government of India Act of 1919, this system of dyarchy that was known as the dual scheme of governance was launched. And it was something like that there were two sorts of subjects, list of transferred subjects, list of reserved subjects. Now, through this Government of India Act of 1935, if you want to listen, if you want to know in detail about this dyarchy, you can view the Government of India Act of 1999 audio tutorial. There I have told this about this in detail. So, through this Government of India Act of 1935, dyarchy in the provinces was abolished. That means the system, dual system of governance in the provincial legislative councils was abolished, and the local provinces were given total autonomy in their administration. That means that the provinces were termed as autonomous units of administration with the defined subjects on which they can legislate. That means that no dual scheme of governance were there, and these provincial units were termed as separate units, demarcated units, autonomous units, which were free in their area of legislation. Through this, responsible government were introduced in the provinces. A large measure of autonomy was provided to the provinces of British India. And in this system, the governor was required to act on the advice of ministers, who in turn were responsible to the provincial legislative council. So, if we compare this act yeah, this provision with the dyarchy system, this provision is more efficient because in modern day administration, this is the sort of thing that we follow even today in India's administrative matters. We know that president is bound to act on the advice of the prime minister and his cabinet ministers. We also know that the governor of the state is bound to act on the advice of the chief minister and his council of ministers. So at that time also, abolishing the dyarchy, this system of provincial autonomy was introduced, in which governor used to act with the advice of the ministers responsible to the provincial legislature. Now, one thing very strange happened at that time. In spite of the efficiency of this process came into effect in 1937, but it was abrogated in 1939. In starting It was introduced in 1937, but it was abrogated, this provision of provincial autonomous units, in which the governor used to work on the advice of the Council of Ministers, who in turn were responsible to the provincial legislature. The system was discontinued, finished, or repealed. So this was the first very important feature of the Government of India Act of 1935. The second most important feature of the Government of India Act of 1935 was that a central bank named as the Reserve Bank of India was launched. The purpose of the starting of the Reserve Bank of India was to control and regulate the financial affairs of the country and the currency and credit of the country. That means, the Reserve Bank of India was entrusted with the task of controlling the currency and financial matters of the country. The third most important point of this act was, a federal court was established in 1937. Fourth most important point, that we know that through the Government of India Act of 1858, the Secretary of State was basically a 15-member Council of Ministers, Council of Members was formed, which was also said as Indian Council. I told you that 15 members were appointed to it, and this was also known as the Council of India, whose job was to assist the Secretary of State in his day-to-day administrative functions. Now, through this Government of India Act of 1935, this Council of India was abolished, and a team of advisors separately was provided to the Secretary of State for India. The next more important point is that in the previous act, I already told you that communalism was legalized. In this act, the concept of separate electorate were further extended, and separate electorates were allotted to women, laborers, and the people of scheduled castes, that is the depressed classes. That means, in addition to the persons and entities to whom previously the system of separate electorates was provided, now the system of separate electorate was also provided to women, to the laborers, and to the persons of depressed classes. Now, one thing I would like to tell you here about the Government of India Act of 1935 was that in this, a provision was made by the British government which did not come into operation at all. The provision was that in spite of that the diarchy system was abolished from the provincial level, it was suggested that this system of diarchy, that is the dual scheme of governance, it should be adopted at the center. That means, the subjects that were known as the federal subjects, they should be divided into two categories of subjects, or two list of subjects, known as the list of reserved subjects and the list of transferred subjects. It is almost the same system which was introduced in the provinces. It was being thought by the British government, the provision was there, that this should be introduced at the center. But this provision was met with huge opposition, vehement opposition was there, and it was not adopted at all. But this provision was there, was present in the Government of India Act of 1935. Now, the next important point was, a Federal Public Service Commission was appointed. A Provincial Public Service Commission was appointed. And a Joint Public Service Commission was appointed. That means, Federal Public Service Commission was appointed to recruit civil servants who can administer affairs at the central level. Provincial Public Service Commission was appointed to select civil servants who can help in administration at the provincial level. And Joint Public Service Commission was formed, in which civil servants were recruited who used to help in the administration of two or more provinces. So I will repeat again. Three types of public service commissions were launched. The first one was Federal Public Service Commission at the central level, a Provincial Public Service Commission at the provincial level or the state level or the local level, and the Joint Public Service Commission, which was used for two or more provinces. The next more important point is that out of the 11 provinces that were present at that time, in 6 provinces, the system of bicameralism was introduced. Now, in my previous audio tutorial, I have already told you what bicameralism means. In lay language, we can say that in bicameralism, a single system of government is changed into a double system of government. That is, two different bodies are made. One is a legislative council, which is also known as upper house, and the second one is a legislative assembly, which is also known as lower house. These houses have their own strength. Some of them are nominated and some of them are elected. This I told you in the previous audio tutorial. Now, if you want to understand bicameralism in deep, I have to upload a different audio tutorial for this, because it is a very huge topic, bicameralism. However, I will upload it after some time. In the meantime, if you want to understand the meaning of bicameralism in the layman, I've already told you what bicameralism means. That is, replacing a single system of government with a double system of government. Double system of government means two bodies with elected and nominated members who can legislate on various subjects, and the assent of both is required to pass a bill or law. So, the important characteristic was that out of the 11 provinces, in six, bicameralism was introduced. That means in 6 provinces, bicameralism was introduced. Those 6 provinces were Bombay, Madras, United Province, that today is known as Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Assam, and Bengal. I will repeat, 6 provinces, Bombay, first one, second one, Madras, third one, United Provinces, that is the today Uttar Pradesh, fourth one, Bihar, fifth one, Assam, and sixth one, Bengal. So these were the 6 provinces in which bicameralism was introduced, that is, a legislative council known as upper house and a legislative assembly known as lower house were formed. However, on their functioning, a lot of, we can say, conditions were superimposed. That is, their areas of powers were defined and there were many subjects mentioned on which they cannot legislate. A whole lot of restrictions and impositions were placed on them. So, they were not totally autonomous in their approach. So, this was one more important feature of this Government of India Act of 1935. Now, the last and one of the most important feature of the Government of India Act of 1935 was that it tried to establish a Federation of India to be made up of both British India and some or all of the princely states. That means it was suggested that an All India Federation consisting of the provinces, the princely states, and the British India is to be formed. And in this, the provinces, the princely states, and the British India will act as units. And the legislative power, that is the power to make law, were divided between the centers and those provincial units. This list of legislation was divided into three different lists. That means all the subjects on which the law can be made, these subjects were placed in three different lists. The name of these lists was, first was the federal list, that is the central list. Second was the provincial list. Third was the concurrent list. Now, if we know the very basic of polity, or even if we have studied some basics of polity or some other, we know that what this federal list, central list, provincial list or concurrent list means. This means that federal list or the center list was that list which contained subjects, subject matters on which only the central government can legislate. At that time, in the federal list, there were 59 subjects. Second, the provincial list or the state list was the list which was for the provinces. It contained a total of 54 subject matters. That is, in the federal list, the central list, there were 59 subject matters. In the provincial state list, there were 54 subject matters. The third one was the concurrent list. Now, concurrent list was comprised of subjects on which both the center and the provinces can legislate. That means on these 36 subjects, both the provincial legislative council and the central legislative council had the power to make decisions. Now, if in some case, in some different case, such a subject arises, which is not mentioned in any of the list, then we term it as residuary list, residuary subjects, R-E-S-I-D-U-A-R-Y, residuary subjects. This means that the residuary list contains residuary subjects. Residuary subjects are those subjects which are not mentioned in any of the lists. So, in detail, if you want to know about the residuary subjects, what this residuary subject means, I would like to quote the example of the current disaster in Uttarakhand. Now, we know that a disaster happened in Uttarakhand recently. A huge cyclone was there and a lot of water and huge destruction was there. It was in newspapers and all over the media. We all know about it. It was a very terrible and sad event. Thousands of people lost their lives in it. So, now when this disaster happened, one thing came out, that the disaster was not present in any of the list. I just quoted the example of Uttarakhand as an example. Many disasters have happened previously in India. So when this disaster came out, a natural calamity came out, which was not in the hands of the state, this subject came to be known as a residuary subject. And it automatically came under the control of the central list. That is, at that time also, the power to legislate on residuary subjects was vested in the center, that is the federation, at the central level. So at that time, with this idea of the establishment of All India Federation, three lists were formed and it tried to engage the provincial areas as units, but such a sort of system never came into existence. It was just a provision which never came into operation or existence because the provinces didn't join it as units. So, it was just on papers, it was never implemented. So, here in detail I have told you about each and every aspect, each and every important aspect of the Government of India Act of 1935. It was a very huge act and it is not important from any exams point of view, including the IAS pre-examination. There was a very huge document and around 395 subject matters were there. So, it is just not necessary so that this much huge discussion is needed to be done here. So, right now, I am wrapping up my lecture of Government of India Act of 1935 because all of the important points of this act of Government of India Act of 1935 I have already told you. So, I hope you like this lecture. The Government of India Act of 1935, all these points, if you have in your mind, no question will be out of these areas. And after listening to the subject matter of this act, now you'd be very much sure in your mind that many provisions of these acts are right now in use in our day-to-day administration in India. So friends, thank you for listening to the audio tutorial. In next audio tutorial, I will tell you about the Indian Independence Act of 1947. Thank you and have a good day. Hello friends, I